Welcome to the Trans Sky, homeland to the Amak Xhosa.
Take a look around, what do you see? There are so many people living life in misery. They need hope, they need. Should be preaching, teaching, preaching, constantly share, care, bringing his hope to the hopeless, helpless, building and building his kingdom of love. Preaching, teaching, preaching, constantly sharing, caring, bringing his hope to the hopeless, helpless, building and building his kingdom. It's not too late. There's a world out there whose heart's about to break. It's up to us who we can point the way. How they need Jesus, that's all I want to say. We should be preaching, teaching, preaching, constantly sharing, caring. Bringing his hope to the hopeless, helpless, building and building his kingdom of love. Preaching, teaching, preaching, constantly sharing, caring, bringing his hope to the hopeless, helpless, building and building his kingdom of love. His kingdom of love, his kingdom of love. Jesus came to build his church made with living stones, to put his love in every heart before he takes.
My name is Nomatata Natofu. I am 95 years old. I thank God for bringing the missionaries over here with the word of God.
Today, one more village was reached. But tomorrow we're facing over 10,000 unreached villages. We can't do it without your prayers, your support. We invite you to join with us in the quest to reach the hidden half of this world. God bless you.
My life?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Open.
Good.
Nice.
Oh, that was a butt dial. But it's so good to be here. It's so nice to worship in English, and it's so different than what I'm used to. I've only been in the States about 5 days, so I'm still kind of, but seeing, worshiping in English and seeing everybody so nice and wearing shoes and so clean, and some of you have taken baths, and I'll talk to guards later, but it's so cool being here. And anyway, I'm excited. Thank you about mentioning the cars. You want a junk mail, fill it out. If you don't want to hear what God's doing in Africa, then I'll pray for you. But they'll collect that somehow at the end. I had a problem yesterday. Among other things, it's kind of a busy, crazy day. But I only, as I said, I only got to the States a few days ago, and I packed in a real hurry. So I had one pair of long pants, and they're kind of all covered with blood. And so I just go, when are you going to church? And so I'm wearing shorts. I'm the only one here in shorts right now. So that's why I'm so California-ish today, I guess. But how many am I new to here that have not heard me share here, Richard? Oh my gosh, more than half of you. Oh, jeez. I know what you're saying. You're saying, this guy looks just like Brad Pitt. I get it all the time. Yeah, don't feel bad. My wife says Danny DeVito, though. I don't get that, but she says that. My wife said the same little greetings. She wants to come down here. I've told her so much about what God's doing here. My wife, yes, she's with the grandkids in Denver right now, but anyway, my wife is my hero. My wife is the most godly person I've ever met in my life. I wish I could be half the woman she is. Wait a second. That would come out quite. Delete that, okay? That's all those Apple supporters. Okay. But anyway, before I begin, I want to apologize for being an African missionary, because I'm going to be sharing this morning, a lot of what I'm going to be sharing is about Africa. I've been there more than half of my life, and working with the tribal people, the unreached, everything from witch doctors to tribal chiefs to warriors to headmen, and all kinds of things. But I'm going to be sharing from an African context. I want you to forgive me, because I don't want to come across like, if you're not in Africa, you know, you're a spiritual midget, you're a Philistine or something, that you're not all called to go to Africa. Oh, good. Yeah, so you can breathe now. But we're all called to reach the lost. Whether it's here in La Plata County, is it called?
Yep.
Yeah, or Colorado, or in Africa, or wherever. We're all called to be part of it. There's no excuse why not to. But, you know, the Lord ended up, you know, took me at the butt into Africa, so not everyone's called it. Anyway, I do have an agenda. I should probably tell you my hidden agenda, so you can leave now. I have my agenda is really not just to shoot an elk, but is to recruit laborers into his harvest field. And I am hoping and praying. Last night, I just was praying that there'd be at least one, maybe two, maybe a half dozen or more people that are called to reach the unreached, the tribal people in the hidden parts of Africa. And that would be so cool. But it's up to the Lord. I can only broadcast see what God does. And I didn't sleep much last night. Not only did we end up working out in the dark, these guys kind of did all the hard work. I learned all about rifles last night. But all of a sudden I got a call at 3 a.m. and one of my kids that works they thought I was in Africa. So they called at 3 a.m. and they said, well, hey, you know, we came to surface and I'm on the sat phone and I thought I'd call you up to see how you're doing. He goes, you weren't sleeping, were you? And I lied and said, oh no. And so one of the kids just said, well, I just wanted to just, you know, say hi, and you know, I go, okay, and what's up? She goes, do you know there's no canaries on Canary Island? And I'm sitting there thinking, oh my gosh, Really? That's really so interesting. And then she said, you know, it's the same thing for the Virgin Islands. And I go, what? And I go, no canaries. I know what you were thinking. I know what you were thinking. Don't go there. But Senator, I said, yeah, I need to get some sleep. So anyway, I kind of slightly yawned and hung up. So I do work with the Xhosa people in the Republic of, former Republic of Transkei. And we've been there, approximately 40 years. We made a 40-year commitment. I think we've really, as a family, only been there 39 years, so got another year to go, and then we'll re-up or do something else, or maybe move to some weird place like Bangladesh or Sri Lanka or, you know, Durango or whatever. But who knows where God will take us after that. Maybe keep us in Africa. But anyway, guys, since I'm new to everybody, or well, not everybody, more than half of you, everybody's wondering, you know, what's he done? Is he fun? Is his son? Can he run? And all that. So I'll tell you a little about me, but that's really not why I'm here, to talk a lot about me, but more than that, about what the Lord is doing and what the Lord wants to say to some of you. I asked Justin, I said, what should I share on the morning? And he says, I don't know. Whatever God puts on your heart. And all of a sudden, he interrupted me wearing this blind, and he goes, God's telling you to share on this. So I will be sharing something in a minute. Before I do, I want to share a little about who I am, what I've done, and let's see what the Lord does. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for this time of being in your living room, being in your presence. So I just pray that you would take charge and you would give us ears to hear, that we wouldn't leave here like we came. Lord, I pray that you'd protect me from myself, that you and you alone would be glorified this day, and we wouldn't leave here like we came. We give this time to you, Lord Jesus. Be glorified, we pray. Mkosi kakula Jesu. Amen. Good. Real quickly, I was born at a young age, and I'm not starting out real good anymore. Born at a young age, I was born to a Jewish home. My grandfather was a rabbi, Orthodox rabbi in Canada. Really, I was born in Canada, in a little town you've probably never heard of called Toronto. And they had a really bad baseball team. But anyway, I was born to a Jewish home. I went through all this years of Hebrew school and synagogue and, everything else, and bar mitzvah. And after I was bar mitzvah at 13, I left the Jewish faith. I went into the world and, I just partied, lived life, I guess. And, I always wondered, because I couldn't find it in Judaism, at least the shul, the synagogue that I was raised in. And, but what's your purpose in life? Because I knew that we all have a purpose. It isn't just to go out and have fun and shoot an elk or go skiing or to make money or to have 2.3 kids or whatever. We have a greater purpose in life. And what, I don't want to miss my purpose. And this year, what is it, 24? 24, okay. I'm in Africa, I'm sorry. But, but it's gone. It's almost gone. It's a month left. And it's kind of like, you can't relive it. And I don't want to waste my life on, and wake up someday when I'm 80 years old and turn over and look at my wife in bed and say, what have we really done that counts? Yeah, we've made money, we've paid off the house, and we've propagated the family name or whatever. But what have we really could have, would have, should have, but we never did because we're too insecure or too you know, chicken or fear of failure. Mm-hmm. And so start looking for purpose. And I was going to a university, and I have a whole bunch of university degrees, which really doesn't help me in Africa. But I really is back then in the hippie days, you know, everybody's looking for meanings of life. And I was no different. Look at Eastern religions and, you know, and all this. Everybody wanted to go to India or, you know, go to be a Hare Krishna or something. I didn't have enough hair to be a Hare Krishna. But I wanted to know what the meaning of, yeah, I was really looking for this and I couldn't find it. And I went to all the wrong places and I never found that purpose in life. The why I was born, was I born just to die? Or do I have a greater purpose? And I really, really wanted to know what you Gentiles, you know, believe. But for some reason, Christians could never share their faith with me. They had to yell. They couldn't just talk. They would yell. And when they yelled, they spit. I don't know why they could. That is kind of King James lisp. And so I don't want them to yell at me and spit on me and all this. But I wondered what do you guys think about killing your old man or washing in blood and all that? And, you know, but no one could really tell me. They always had to yell. And I'm from Montana, and one of those transplants to, you know, I guess, I don't know if I'd say I live in Colorado, but I live in Africa. But up in Montana, I met this logger who I got to be close with, and he was a Christian. And I had a similar background. He's a druggie and a party guy and all this. I was a druggie and a, you know, party guy. I know none of you have ever done any of that because you're all Christians. But anyway, I'm sorry, I wasn't always a Christian. But he didn't yell, he didn't spit, but he answered all these questions for me. I'd have really stupid questions. And then he said something that really shocked me. He said, salvation is a free gift from God. Well, as soon as he said free to a Jewish guy, duh, of course I took it. It was double coupon day, I would have gotten saved twice. But, you know, I got saved on a freebie. Yeah, but I'll see where the Lord's going to go on this, but I just want to say, I'll see if I can keep this short. Encapsulate this. But I was saved for, say, 3 years, and I accepted Jesus into my heart. I believed him to be the Messiah. I believed in the Word of God. Jesus was my Savior. And for the first 3 years of being a Christian, but I never, never knew the Lord Jesus. I knew an academic Jesus. I knew one in Sunday school and all this other stuff, but I never knew the Lord Jesus. And then somehow the penny dropped in around in my third year of walking with Jesus that he's Lord. Amen. I go, what is that? I mean, we said he's, and at the time there's a guy by the name of Keith Green. Some of you old farts kind of remember Keith. And Keith Green made a statement that he's either Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. Right. You know, and he can't be just a 10% Lord or a 30% Lord, and you're living for yourself, following the American dream or your own little dream or purpose. But you're either, he's Lord, you're servant, 100%, or not at all. And so I just go, wait. No one told me this when I signed up for this whole Christianity thing, that I had to be a servant. And I, you know, and And he's saying to let go of my own personal purpose in life and to serve him 100%, not 30%, not Sundays and Wednesdays, but 100%. I go, well, that's a little radical. You know, I worked really hard. I had a CPA corporation in Montana. I was a financial advisor to the governor. I taught at the college and stuff like this. And, you know, been to law school and other things. I worked really hard to be where I'm at. And now the Lord's saying, I want you to trash your life if it needs be and live for me. I go, I don't know about that. I don't know. I worked pretty hard to get to where I'm at. And but he's either Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. You can't play games. He's not negotiating. You know, and I tried to negotiate with the Lord. It's so funny. You know, it's like wrestling with a sumo wrestler. You end up in some orifice you don't want to be in. You know, he wins. You know, so all of a sudden, you know, I just go, okay, I surrender all. And I'll trash my life. Whatever it is, Lord, I'll give up the American dream of, you know, whatever I aspired to have. We had a few hundred acres of ranch in Montana and other businesses. It says, I'll go and do whatever you're calling me to do. Vodka. Hey, this is cool, man. I can see why you have the spirit.
Yeah. I thought it was supposed to be wine.
Church of Smirnoff. But anyway, I will go 100% for you. You know, but I'm not going to lie and say it was easy, but, you know, it was more little things in my life. It wasn't necessarily bad, big things, like financial things you could see, but things in my heart, attitudes, sins, secret sins, or, you know, ways of thinking, that I would be moldable, crushed, broken down, that he could pour in the water and reshape me from the inside out, and not with a bunch of chunks of the old Kelly. So out of that, I said, okay, I'll go all in. You know, I'm going to, like the same thing, is I'm going to go all in, put my chips on the big G and let the wheel spin. And so I did it. And then the Lord started showing me the lost of the world. And in Montana, there's, you know, you can get, you know, find a cowboy church at any corner and the gospel is always on the radio. But I didn't realize there's people that lived in darkness, people that never even had any hope, people that live a life of pain and crying because they've never known Christ. And I got exposed to it. I had I wish I had more time. I had a vision, and I don't have a lot of visions, but I had a vision of being in the presence of the Lord. Matter of fact, I'll just take a second and share this vision because it so changed my life. Where all of a sudden, I got called up to go to the Oval Office in Washington, D.C. or wherever. I never share this story. And it's kind of like if you go to, you know, see the president, whoever he or she is nowadays, you know, you're going to go there on Thursday, and kind of like, that would be pretty awesome to go to the White House and, you know, see the president. So I went to the Oval Office, and I took a few steps to the right, and it's bigger than I thought. And there was, I guess, the president, this big executive chair, looking over a whole bank of windows, a whole wall of windows looking over, you know, the East Lawn or West Lawn or Forest Lawn, or I don't know. And I just was really intimidated. Like, if you're gonna see a president, you know, what would you wear? What would you say? How would you fix your hair? Oh, I didn't have that problem. But and all of a sudden, in the window, I could see faces of people with dark eyes that had the appearance of being deaf or hurting, people of a darker skin or a different racial ethnicity, and fading in and out, kind of like how they do in the movies, and kind of wigged me out. It's kind of very uncomfortable. And I, at that point, wanted to leave the vision. I wanted to take two steps to the left and say, I'm out of here. But then the executive chair turned around, and it wasn't Biden or Trump or anybody else, but it was the Lord. And the Lord was crying. He was weeping. And he had a broader vision of the loss than I had. But when you see somebody of you know, stature, and he didn't say anything, but I knew for the first time that I was called to be part of preaching. Sorry. Reaching the Lord. Reaching the lost for the Lord. So, out of that whole vision, you know, the Lord is saying, I'm calling you to leave Montana and go to the unreached parts of the world.
Come on.
And, and surprisingly enough, it was shocking, but it wasn't that hard. It wasn't hard going. It would be probably hard staying. But the problem I said is, Lord, I'll go and do whatever you want. But you have one problem. You got to tell my wife, Kathy, that we're going to trash our lives and go to Devil's Island or some weird place. So I didn't put little tracks on the toilet seat, said missions or missions magazines. I didn't say anything. I just prayed for, I think around 9 months. And I didn't say anything about missions, kept it there. And then we're driving back up where we lived in Lincoln County, Montana, and through a whiteout snowstorm. And you folks here probably have experienced whiteout snowstorms. And it's just her and I driving back home in a whiteout. And all of a sudden she started convulsively crying and sobbing. And you know, I go, whoa, what is this, senior moment or tropical moment? Or, yeah, I didn't know. And she said, Kelly, could you pull over to the side of the road? There's something I need to confess. I go, oh man, is it the milkman or the mailman? Will I get the pickup truck and the dog at least? Or, you know, I'm just thinking, should I pull over or not? And so I pull over thinking, yeah, the worst. And I'm holding on the steering wheel. I go, okay, what is it? And she goes, in the middle of her sobs and her runny nose and all that, she goes, Kelly, I believe we're called to reach the lost of the world. And I said, really? Like missions? She goes, yes, missions. And I go, okay, but if it doesn't work out, it's your fault. You know, I'm game, but, you know. So at that point, we're on the same page, but we got turned down by 52 mission organizations. We're too old, or had too many kids, they said. We had, I think, 5 kids at the time. Our 6th one was born in Africa. She's so funny. She comes here to college now and says, tells everybody she's African-American. Yeah, and there she looks like a marshmallow in the cocoa. Yeah, she is not African, but don't tell her. You know, I don't want to burst her bubble. But anyway, so we got turned down by everybody, and so I said to Kathy, I go, are you sure we're called, you know, missions? And she goes, yeah, we're called, but know, doesn't seem like anybody really wants us. We have no theological training. I was just a, you know, CPA tax guy. And so I just go, well, how's God going to find us in the middle of mud puddle Montana somewhere? And, you know, how can you find anybody in Montana, really? People go there not to be found. But so we just go, well, we're called. And all of a sudden, a couple weeks later, I got a call from the U.S. Center for World Missions, a friend of mine named Gene, who I met. And he says, Kelly, I hear you're being called to missions. And I go, oh, yeah, yeah, I think we are. He goes, do you know where? I go, well, pretty sure it's going to be Mexico or Latin America. And he said, well, how do you know that? And I go, well, I like Mexican food. And I had to be honest with him, because that your only reason? And I go, yeah. And he thought I was a real Philistine, a real spiritual midget. And so he goes, well, what do you think of the trans sky? Is that some airlines? I don't know. And so I don't know what you're talking about. He goes, it's this little country in Africa, homeland to the Xhosa people. And at the time, there were 5 million people, 80% unreached, never seen a white person, never heard about this Jesus guy or anything. And because of sanctions of South Africa, the World Mission Force wouldn't go to places like the Trans Sky. It's pretty isolated. And so I said, you know, I don't think Africa, and not called that. I'll tell you what, I'll pray about it. That was my mistake. Church, I tell you, don't pray about anything unless you want God to speak to you. You know, just don't even go there. But if you pray, be prepared for God to speak to you. And it's really weird. For next month or so, I was running into people from Africa. And, you know, National Geographic was doing a special on Africa. And I remember coming home and our kids were watching Lion King. I said, turn it off. Stop it. So other than that, we went to say, okay, Lord, I'll go to Africa for 30 days to show you we're not called to Africa. And I don't think they have Mexican food there. So I said, I'll give you 30 days. So I went there, I said I'd go down there. So my business partner goes, what are you doing? Why? And I go, I don't know. It's just kind of go. And one of my dentists, yeah, he said, can I go? And one of my clients, so there's around 4 of us that went down to Africa. Now, you guys are one of the very few churches that I can share this story with, because most churches I would never ever share this story. But we went down there for 30 days, and 2 things happened that so radically changed my life. And the first one is, saw around 300 to 500 people come to Christ. That's not back then it was a big thing for me, because from being from nowhere, Montana, yeah, that's big. Now we might see it by showing the Jesus film in Xhosa or setting up a big revival tent. We might see that in one night. But back then, to see so many people come to Christ, and I was just amazed. And the second one is, it's embarrassing, but I saw my first miracle, and I didn't fully believe in miracles. You know, I read about it in the Bible, and thought, that's kind of cool, it's kind of a storybook, maybe it happened then. But I never really believed in miracles, you know. Maybe as a dispensational, I don't know. And you know, I see these guys on TV that make the leg grow or shrink, or guys like, anybody here Benny Hinn? That guy has great hair, doesn't he? Of course, any hair would be good, but anyway, what was it? So anyway, but I saw by first miracle. And when you see a miracle happen, it changes your whole paradigm, your whole view. God is from a little God with small case letters to a big giant God that you can't put into a box.
Yeah.
And it just, it's pretty blown away. Now, if somebody came into my church and talked about miracles, I'd say, you know, is this guy being evangelistic or, you know, stretching the truth or making it? But when you see it and touch it and you're part of it, it's so changes your life. It talks in the scripture about being given a measure of faith. Your faith goes off the faith meter when you see God do something. And then I'm not talking about healing, your a broken leg or, your ingrown toenails or something like that, or your finance. I'm talking about, I'll just tell you the one most dynamic. This is the first one. It's seen a lot since. But where we were driving down the road, and there's this dead boy on the side of the road. And it's around, I guess around 10 years old, and you do see a lot of dead people there. And there's a, so I said, hey, let's stop. Yeah, he's a dead boy, and the birds hadn't pecked out his eyes yet. And so let's go pray for him. And the other guys go, no, come on, we have to kind of get to where we're at. And we had a local guy that was driving the Jeep. And I go, come on, just give me a couple minutes. So I ran over there and started praying for this kid. And I was yelling and shouting in the King James lisp and thought God was a little deaf, so I had to go a little louder. And giving him a Pentecostal back rub and all this stuff. And after around 5 minutes, this little boy was deader. Is there such a word as deader? But he wasn't alive. And meanwhile, there's around 5 or 6 villagers that came over. They heard me shouting, kind of like, what's this white guy, Lungu, doing with this boy? And meanwhile, the guys that went there are still in the Jeep. They go, Kelly, the natives are restless. We need to kind of get going. I go, no, that's it. I went to the Jeep and I got the dipstick out of the engine, got old Pennzoil in this kid's head, thinking that would work. And I was even praying in King James, whatever. And went back to praying and nothing happened after another 5-10 minutes. And now there's around 20 villagers kind of coming around, kind of curious. And then, meanwhile, the guys are still in the Jeep, but the Jeep's running now. I think they're going to leave me. But as a last ditch effort, I didn't take, dead raising 101 in college or anything, so I didn't know what I was doing. So I prayed that the Lord would set him free of his demons. And when I prayed that measure, I don't understand if he started gurgling up kind of a gray foam like grits. And he wasn't walking and leaping and praising God, but he was alive. Wow. From having no pulse, being stiff and dead. Wow. And no breath. And so now all of a sudden these 20 native guys really are coming in closer and they go, wow. And the guys came off from the Jeep and with the local driver, and he interpreted, so now what do I do? So these local people are there, the guys I'm with saying, hey, that's pretty cool, Kelly. I do it all the time. I got a letter in high school, dead raising. But what do you do with the all of a sudden 20 people that get saved? And I didn't know, because I'm not a minister, I'm just a dysfunctional bookkeeper. And so I said, I didn't know what to do. So I said, okay, you have to get on your knees. I got really Catholic for some reason. I don't know. I saw some movie or something. So they all got on their knees and they go, oh crap, now what am I gonna do? And so And so with the local driver, you know, we led him to Christ in a place called Ambolo. And we still have a church there now. And but in doing that, all of a sudden, my reality of God is way bigger than I had even fathomed.
Yeah.
From your typical box church. Yeah. And since then, we have seen other things like this. We've seen people raised from the dead, and not just our ministry, but other ministries in Africa. So it's not unique to us. I don't have some special olive oil or anything. But anyway, I came back from that, and I said, came to Kathy, and I said, Kathy, guess what? She goes, we're going to Africa, aren't we? I go, yeah. She goes, I'm already packing. And so we made a mistake. We read Matthew 19, and that was a mistake. If you're going to go on a mission field, just rip that one out of the Bible. That's about the rich young ruler. It says, if you really want to enter into a new dimension of the kingdom, you want more of the kingdom and go deeper and go to higher ground, you know, take everything you have, sell it, give it away, get rid of it, and follow me. And the rich young ruler could not do that. You know, he couldn't give up all that he had in this world. And he goes off into the sunset, and you never hear from him again. And we didn't want to be like the rich young ruler. So we read that and said, so we gave everything we had away. We'd take all our stuff up to the Amish community up on the other side of the Kootenai, and had the auction, and we gave away hundreds of acres of land. We gave away 3 houses, we gave businesses. And my wife was a county public health nurse, and obviously I was a professional. And so we gave everything we had away, and we moved off to Africa. And we didn't keep a nest egg or something to go back on. It's kind of like when you got married, you didn't say, Mom and Dad, keep my room the way it is in case it doesn't work out with this church, you know? When you make a commitment, it's a commitment. And so we didn't hold anything back. And we ended up in Africa, in the Republic of Transkei, working with the Xhosa people. And we took a few little mini courses on missions, but it wasn't much. And we're down there, and no one spoke English. There's no electricity or water or anything like that. We collected water off the roof. Later on we had a generator, but, and there's no, obviously no white people. I tried to evangelize the best you can. And learning the language and all that is kind of difficult. But I came home one day, and my wife was at the back door, and there's around 4 or 5 native people, also mamas. And she had a leg of apples, a box of apples. And she's giving a few apples to each one of the ladies. And I go, what are you doing? She goes, oh, they're hungry. I go, well, remember that course we took and said, give them the gospel, silver or gold, have I none, just give them Christ. Are we called here to give out apples? Do we have enough apples to feed the whole country? They're just going to want apples and not Christ. And you're doing it all wrong. She goes, Kelly, they're hungry. Okay, do whatever you want. And so after another month went by, I had no converts, and she had 50 ladies every morning she was ministering to. And I said, can I get some apples from you? And I hate it when she's always right. And so anyway, other than that, we started learning the language and going out and with our kids and so on. And we were going to unreached villages. By the way, let me mention that the country now is 9 million people, and we used to have around 5 to 10 missionaries. Now it's 9 million people, And there's no zero missionaries other than Kathy and I. So it's Kathy and I to reach 9 million. Around half of them are reached to some degree. And so we have an awesome task. And that's why we're still doing it, because no one else is doing it. Everyone else is, you know, has a ministry in Hawaii or Acapulco or telling people turn or burn or, you know, anoint them with oil, or I don't know what they do in Hawaii. But no one's going down to Africa. So we start going to the village. Now, it is important when I'm sharing, there's a reason why I'm sharing. We're going to the village, and I was taking this one guy from Knoxon, Montana, pastor out, and going to another unreached village. We start at sunset, and we go, when you were there, you went out to the villages, didn't you? Yeah, and you start at least till midnight, if not early morning hours. Yeah, so you can ask them. And we'd see what, maybe 100 people come to Christ a night. Yeah. So you don't have to believe me, ask them. We'd start at sunset and go till, like, probably start preaching till the middle of the night. People get saved every night. 100, 150 people get saved every night. So going in with this guy, and he says, "What do you preach?" I go, "I just preach John 3:16. He goes, "Is that all you preach?" And his pastor is telling, you know, I go, "Yeah, well, really I got 5 sermons. He goes, "You only have 5 sermons, really?" "Yeah, 3 of them are stolen." He goes, "You steal sermons? They're my best ones. And if I hear Justin share a good message, I'll steal it. If when I get to Africa, you can sue me whatever you want. I don't care. I have no scruple. If it's from the Lord, I'll steal it." And but anyway, the reason I want to say that to you is because there's some of you here who said, "I could never be a missionary. I don't have a theological degree. I'm not a public speaker. I don't know the word in the Hebrew or Greek or whatever." But if you have John 3:16, if you can steal one of Justin's or somebody else's sermons, you can be effective at the bottom end of Africa. So don't say you can't. And so as we go out, you know, probably within the first, couple of years, we had at least 100 churches. Wow. Now we've started over 1,760 churches in Africa. And the Lord's doing that. And I go there and say blue cheese, people get saved. I mean, you know, people say, "Yeah, how does it happen?" You know, and even here in La Plata County, if you have fertile soil, it even makes a bad farmer look good. Yeah. And I'm working fertile soil. I got great leaders, which you have met many of, some of them. So good soil, great leaders, and a God that's touching down. Yeah. And so I just show up for photo ops. And they think I'm a great missionary. And I do squat. You know, and but God's doing it. And so we have all these churches. Then we have somebody come out and say, every night, you know, people get saved. They said, "It's very cool, but the Great Commission isn't to make converts of all nations. Where's your discipling?" Amen. And I'll say, go, "Oh my gosh, she's right. We're putting all our notches on our Bible, saying, look at all we're doing, but we weren't discipling them." So out of that, we tried different ways of doing it. Some were more effective than others. But ultimately, I'm trying to make it short, but we ended up starting a Bible college. And I go, this was a mistake. But because I've never been to Bible college, and but I go, there's already good Bible colleges all over the place. But come to realize there's no Bible colleges for the native indigenous people there, the Xhosa. They'd have to learn a white man's language, they'd have to go to a white man's city, they'd have to finish high school, they have to pay money, they'd have to, you know, they don't have money, they don't have a high school diploma. And so really the African people didn't have the opportunity that the more affluent people in South Africa would have. So we started a Bible college, and I, as to be honest with you, it's kind of scary, because I don't feel qualified. But when your vision is so big it scares you, it's got to be God.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid to pray big and follow God big. And don't be afraid of failing.
Yeah.
It's okay to fail. You know, I fail daily, but it's so cool that tomorrow the Lord kind of forgets about that and have a new day. And so now we started a Bible college that would put out thousands of leaders. And right now, it's probably the most prominent Bible college. And we're really looking forward to Justin and Garth going over there. Did you share the Bible college, didn't you? Yeah. Okay, yeah. So God can use them. He can use you. Yeah. But no, they were great. But so now we're discipling everybody, but now we have another problem, is that if half the people in tonight's outreach get saved, people in the village get saved, half of them are going to die in the next 2-3 years because of a pandemic called HIV or AIDS. 48% of the people are HIV positive.
Wow.
So knowing that, you know, as you fall in love with the people and you start discipling them, that they're ultimately going to die. So you get tired of burying people. We bury somewhere between 5 and 7 people every day. And with the COVID thing, it was up to 15 a day. We had even had to get a backhoe because we couldn't keep up with the dead, bloated bodies. But so what are you gonna do with a pandemic like 48% have AIDS? So we went to government, we went to UN, we went to State Department, we went World Health, and nothing was being done. And the Lord said, Kelly, why don't you do something about it? I don't know anything about it. And the Lord started showing that, let me put it real short. Lord encouraged us, led us to build a hospital. Last year we saw 68,000 people through our hospital.
Wow.
Now, I'm not a medical person. Like 2 weeks ago, my wife sent me to a store to get, she wanted to get what's called B12. And so I got 2 bottles of B6. Now I was a math major, I know what I'm talking about. But she's saying, no, it doesn't work like that. Don't tell her, you know. But you know, she has a medical background. So the Lord used us once again. When your vision is so big it scares you, it's got to be God. Mm. Don't be afraid to think big, pray big. But I will warn you, it is going to cost you. You know, what do they say at the gym? No pain, no gain. You know, it is going to cost you. I'm not going to lie to you. But the return on your investment in the kingdom, having a purpose in your life, is well worth it. And let me just wrap this up by saying, and get to really what I want to talk about, is that the fallout of the HIV pandemic is that of the 9 million people, we have almost 2 million orphans that have no parents. There'll be families of 5 that the oldest person in the family is 12 years old. And so we started the children's center. Did you guys go there too? Okay. We had children's center, children's shelters, and now we have trauma centers now, which is a whole different thing. That's really horrible things that you get over there. But now we're starting a ministry right now, the church here in Durango is feeding over 2,000 children every day, caring for them, whether it's giving them de-lysing medicine or deworming or whatever we do with them. And some of our children's centers teach them not just the gospel and hygiene and all that, but teach them how to read and write and prepare them for life. And so we're doing things, and it's not just us, but we've partnered with this crazy church in Durango called Recalibrate. But together, God's doing an awesome thing. And I'm here to just say thank you guys for praying for us, standing with us, and all that we do. Because, you know, it might not seem like much to you, but to us, it's everything. We don't have doctors. I stitch people up with dental floss. I pull teeth with channel locks. I deliver babies and all the other stuff, hundreds of them. Matter of fact, if I could brag for a minute, just 1 minute, that four of our pastors I delivered as babies. You know? So that's kind of what I do. Anyway, so now the ministry is still growing. And we're still doing it. But right now we're looking at tens of thousands of unreached villages, and it's just Kathy and I, and some of our leaders and graduates of their Bible college and all that, but we can't keep up with them. We have a list of three or four hundred people that have been waiting, villages that have been waiting over 2 years for this gospel. And we are trying to reach them as fast as we can, but we can't do it all. We have the beachhead waiting for God's troops to arrive. So we're doing what we can. And let me just confess something. I can stand up here and you might think, yeah, this is a great missionary and all that, or whatever. But the truth is, we're just scratching the surface. We're just barely making an impact. You know, for us to baptize over 50,000, you know, when you're talking about 9 million people, that's nothing. And so, but we're doing it, waiting for God's troops to arrive, and just hoping and believing and praying that some of you here, maybe we're not talking about going over there and just take some pictures for, you know, 3 days or get a t-shirt after 2 months, but talk about giving it all for the Lord, making him 100% God and going all the way. Everybody here has an excuse why not to go. Everybody, it's incredible. Last time I was in America, a lady came up to me, an older lady, and she said, "Well, Brother Kelly, I would go to Africa and join you, but I'm 65 years old." And I go, "Well, I'm 75. And you go, oh. She goes, "But Brother Kelly, you don't realize I have 3 grandchildren." I go, "Well, I have 12 grandchildren." So then she's really grabbing for something. She goes, "Well, Brother Kelly, I have a bad knee." You don't even go there. A bad knee. Oh my gosh, at least she has a knee. So You know, but you all have excuses. But at the end of the day, I don't know if God's going to buy into your excuses. Are you going to hear the words, well done, good and faithful, or no, I don't want to leave my comfort zones. I worked really hard to, you know, build my life here in Colorado. You're going to have all kinds of excuses, but I don't know if the Lord's going to buy it. Are you going to hear the words, depart from me? I don't even know you. You know, yeah, you went to church. You played the game. You have the bumper sticker. You go to Bible studies. You might even, you know, have some task. And by the way, I want to thank the young man that made the coffee this morning. But the Lord might be calling you to something else. Might be calling all of us to something much, much bigger. But it's going to cost you. You can't have it both. You can't live for yourself and live for Him. So to just say, just be praying that some of you might want to have a life with a purpose and not realize when it's too late that you wasted your life on your own little plans and dreams that you thought too little. You wasted your life. And remember as a kid, seems like summers would go on forever. Now they just fly by. And like, it seems like it goes faster now. And some of you with snow on the roof, you know what I'm talking about. You know, it's, the older you get, it seems like, and I can't waste my tomorrow. I can't wait this next year. I don't know how much time I have left, but I don't want to waste it on myself. Because I have a purpose, and each one of you, like my brother over there said this morning about each one of us is a minister. Each one of us has a purpose. And if you hear what he said, he wasn't just flopping his gums. He was speaking the word of the Lord. Each one of you have a calling, but are you too chicken, insecure, fear of failure, whatever it is, but step out of the boat and see what God wants to do with you. And let God help you if you do nothing. Now, once again, you're not all called to go to Africa, but you are called to live a life with the purpose of furthering His kingdom. And He's given you the Word. He's given you the Holy Spirit. He's empowered you. But what are you doing with it? Just kind of just wallowing in it? He's equipped you for a purpose. Don't waste the giftings and the purpose and deposits He's made in your life. This morning, take a break for a second. Inhale, exhale, a little back up. I think I lost my mic. Okay. Am I still alive?
Yep.
Okay. We're in this blind yesterday. I was talking to Justin and talking about, you know, on your deathbed, what is the greatest wisdom you can pass to your kids? You know, if somebody's dying, it's their last night on earth. They're going to have their homecoming tomorrow. What is it? And you ask them, what's it all about? What pearls of wisdom, pearls of great price, could you give them? And, just say don't smoke cigars in bed or don't play poker with a guy named Mace or something. You know, whatever you're going to say on your dying deathbed, it's probably going to be the most valuable thing you've ever said. And as we're talking about it, it's kind of like, you know, Justin, I'm paraphrasing now. Kelly, you've been ministry, walking with the Lord, ministering for all these years. What is the nucleus of what you could pass on? And could you share that with the church? And you share with it, it's not complicated, it's not long, but it's just three things. Now, before I share it, some of you came to church this morning thinking, well, it's Sunday, we gotta go to church, you know? And, you know, because it's Sunday, you know, because you're supposed to, because, you know. And some of you came for different purposes, you know? Like, Justin gets paid to come. Yeah, yeah. He's paid to be good, and the rest of you are good for nothing. So why are you here? But there's some of you that have had the audacity, as you're waking up this morning, saying, Lord, I don't want to leave here like I came. I don't want to stay on a plateau where I was 5 years ago. I want to go to higher ground. I want more of you. I want more of the kingdom. I don't want to just play the church game. And there's those of you that are really open that will hear maybe something the Lord might say. Those of you that are too busy focusing on your fancy football league won't hear anything. But when I first got saved, just 3 points, when I first got saved, I used to think the most important thing in being a Christian was knowing the Word. And I still believe knowing the Word is very important. But I thought if I could memorize vast books of the Bible and know the entire books or and study it in the Hebrew and all this stuff. And so I devoted myself the first 3 years of being a Christian to studying and knowing the Bible. And then I met some theologians down in Dallas that really knew the Word, but they didn't know the Lord. It was really weird. They never had an experience with the Lord. Nothing in their life exemplified the power of the Holy Spirit moving in their life. But they knew the Word. They knew all about it. But they never experienced. You can have a chemical breakdown of all the formula of making chocolate ice cream, but until you taste it, you know, it's just words on a page.
Come on.
And so I realized knowing the Word is good, but it's not the goal. I didn't get saved just to read the Bible. When I was stationed overseas, you get mail when you're in Nam and stuff like that, and it really means a lot to you, and someone writes you and tells you that you're missed, you're loved, and all this other stuff, and the Lord, His Word, has written it to you to equip you for a purpose. But my purpose wasn't just to sit around and read mail and read His Word. It's good. So I go, well, if that's not it, then what do I need to do? And then I went to the second point, is to go, it's not knowing, it's doing. And I thought, well, if I knew I couldn't pay back God. It's not works. It's not, you know, you have to earn your way into heaven. But I wanted to do what pleases Him. And so out of that is part and parcel to us trashing our lives and going to Africa. And after almost 40 years in Africa, I realized that's really not it. And whether you've baptized 5 people and I've baptized 50,000. It doesn't really, God doesn't keep a scorecard. But, and then realize it's not what you do that even counts. Now, I love my wife very much, and we're married, and I love to bring her breakfast in bed or coffee in bed. I don't have to, but because I love her, and I want to do what pleases her. I don't have to. She doesn't force me. The same thing with the Lord is not what you know. I know my wife pretty good. She knows me pretty good. We're always learning. But it's not what you know, and it's not what you do that counts. That if I've reached 4 people than you, am I gonna have a better seat at the banqueting table? Do I get seconds on my dessert? Or, you know, it's, the Lord's not impressed by what we know or what we do, but the Lord is impressed by what we are. That's the third point. And that's the message this morning. What are you? And that's Him being in you, and you in Him. Being interfaced, where there's no longer a separation. You and Him become one. And I was telling him about this guy I met named Lee Gold. And he has surgery in his abdomen somewhere. And they left a bunch of gauze in the surgery. And for years after he had the surgery, he's always sick and painful, and you know, 5-10 years, didn't know what was going wrong. So they opened him up again, you know, 10-15 years later, and they realized there's all this gauze that was still left inside him. And he's been suffering with this, but they couldn't remove the gauze because it became part and parcel to his tissue. It became part of him. And that illustrated, like, when you have the Lord in you, you and the Lord become one. You become so interfaced and integrated, you become one. And it's not like He's over there and I'm over here and I'm going to do things to please Him. We become one. And so, like when I do a wedding, you say, okay, you and her two become one. It sounds really nice, but when you come to a place where the Lord dwells in you, in everything you do, and a guy who's traveling with me, a friend of mine, Peter, he just goes, excuse me for using it as an example, Peter, but Peter said to me the other day, he goes, gosh, Kelly, you know, you just see God in everything that, you know, happens, you know, every, you know, whether it's at the coffee shop or missing an elk or getting an elk or having a flat tire, whatever it is. But because you and the Lord, your life becomes the Lord's life. Yeah. And is He Lord of your life? Or are you just a Christian attending, coming to His house? He wants to dwell in you. You're the temple of the Holy Ghost. Not this building here. And he's created you for a purpose. Not just to know the Bible, not just to do, but He wants to dwell inside you. He wants you to give up 100%, not 10%, not 40, not 70. He's not negotiating. He wants all of you. And some of you saying, like the rich young ruler, you're asking way too much. I can never give up 100%. I've worked all my life to get to where I'm at. And I finally paid off the mortgage or whatever it is. And I'm not gonna give it up. And you can be like the rich young ruler going off into the sunset and missing the greatest opportunity in your life. Missing the purpose in your life. And so on my deathbed, I would say, knowing is good. Doing is good. But having, being one with Him, where He is no longer just a God up there and you here, but He becomes your friend. How many people would rather go to a Bronco game with their buddies, but they'll never go to a Bronco game with their friend Jesus? They'll ride in their car with their friends or listen to radio, but they won't turn the radio off to listen, spend time with their best friend Jesus. He wants to be your best friend. He wants to be one with you. And He sent me 10,000 miles to be here today, not to entertain you or enlighten you. I don't have great wisdom, but to invite you, like the rich young ruler, to invite you into that dimension of the kingdom where you're 100%. As much as you can be. Am I 100% sold out? Yeah, it's like weeding your lawn in the fall. In the springtime, all of a sudden you have more weeds in your lawn. And it's kind of like every day I see areas that I haven't given 100% to. Areas that are still living in me that I need to get purged out. But it's an ongoing process. But it's not performance, but it's my heart's desire is to do what pleases my wife on earth, but more than that, what my life desires to please my Lord. He is my Lord, and I love Him. And I want to invite anybody here. You don't have to come up and make a show about it. You don't have to raise your hands or do anything. But whether it's tonight in the quietness of your own solitude, wherever you're at, or whenever, make a decision saying, I no longer want to play games and be a 40% Christian. Yeah. I want to be sold out. I want to be a fanatic. And like the definition of fanatic is somebody who knows God more than you. I want to be a fanatic. I want to die with a purpose and go on and hear those words, well done, good and faithful. I just hope that the Lord might speak to you guys this morning. That wouldn't it just be another Sunday morning? And but that you might re-examine where you're at and where He's at and what He's calling you to do. Don't have to go to Africa, but maybe. But He is calling you to do and live 100% for Him. This generation can only be reached by this generation. And He's entrusted you with the good news. I don't know why He wants to use you or me, but He does. He uses the foolish things in this world to dumbfound all the theologians down in Dallas. He wants to use you. You don't have to go to seminary or have an MDiv or whatever, but He wants to use you. Everything you've got and everything you're not, He wants 100% of you. I'm going to let the Lord deal with you on that. As I'm going to turn the pulpit over to Pastor Justin, I'm going to show just another little two-minute video to just wrap it up. And you can start it whenever you start. I'll stop, which is probably good. And
Africa, a beautiful continent whose people live on the land and daily strive to feed and nurture their families. The children carry the promise of God's destiny for future generations. They are the hope of God's promise for tomorrow. It is here, to this place, that God has called Kelly Kosky to bring the truth of his salvation and the joy of his amazing grace.
Kathy and I have spent over half our lives reaching the lost in these remote villages.
Kelly's love for the people of the Transkei motivates him to travel thousands of kilometers across the vast open plains of the rural Transkei.
As we're working to reach the hidden half of this world, we couldn't do it without you. We're bringing the light to those in darkness. And we thank the Lord that he's able to do what we can't do. As you watch this video, it gives you something to pray for. As we are reaching the tens of thousands of unreached villages and the over 5 million Xhosa.
This is the journey that Kelly takes to reach the unreached with God's message. Praying for those who are afflicted by disease, teaching those who long to learn about God's truth, and preaching a message of hope.
It's not always fun for the local people, but the Lord died on the cross so they could have joy, and we're bringing the hope to those that are in darkness, bringing joy to those who are sad and grieving.
This is God's servant on the great African continent, Kelly, the servant of God, who is willing to go where others have not yet been.
As the day closes here in Transkei, we look at not just one more village, but we look at tens of thousands of villages that we haven't been able to reach today. But tomorrow's another day. Tomorrow's another day to go into the villages and reach the lost, the unreached. But we can't do it alone. We need you to join us in prayer, support, and hopefully even coming out here and being part of what God's doing to reach the lost. We want to thank you for standing with us in the quest to reach one more village. Nkosi Kakulu Jesu. Amen.